Well, I got it apart or cleaned out, and very interesting is all I can say. This in the bottom, that's not rusted metal. That's actually a coating, like a tar coating on the metal. The sides have some surface rust, but nothing too severe. If you look right here, that's where the thermostat well would have originally been brazed on there, soldered on, and there's the hole where it went through. So that's missing. That's why I thought it was weird that the thermostat probe just went up into the insulation. It's because that piece is broken off. And over here, this is the Frigidaire restrictor device. That's essentially the last of the capillary tube coiled up in there, coming in here, and this is a return back to the compressor. This stem is a overflow drain. It's just shy of the top. So when the insulation is put in there correctly, this is up here. So if you put a bottle of water on and spill water all over the top of that, it can go through there. And actually, it looks like it just falls on the floor, for there's nothing underneath there. But that will be a better alternative than it going in the insulation. This thing looks like brass. It's thick too. You can see the line goes inside it. I don't understand how it was made. Maybe double walled. I don't know. Super high, you know, custom. It's obviously a high quality product. That's all I can say. It's a lot of engineering went into it, and more than likely a whole lot of hand assembly too. Now, being that this is a drinking water fountain, when this top is open, just covered by the water bottle, I can't use any kind of sealant or anything in here that'll have a smell to it. So I'm really constrained in what I can use to restore this. if I put any kind of paint in here to try to kill that rust or something that has a lingering odor, it's going to go in the water. So I haven't figured out yet what I'm going to do about the rust in there. I may not have much of a choice. It may just have to stay like that, and versus rendering this useless for its intended purpose by contaminating it with something that'll have a taste. But I'm gonna do a little more research on that. But first order of business is gonna be to try and solder on a new thermostat well. I think that should be clean enough to solder, and I got just a piece of 3/8 tubing. I'm going to stick it down through there where it's accessible from below. Take a big clamp and clamp it on like that, and then try to put a little bit of a Stay-Brite on it. Something like that ought to hold it. Well, I ended up laying it on its side to get the solder to flow and not just drip off. I believe that's got a pretty good bond there on both sides. It shouldn't break back off easily, and it should have good thermal conductivity to sense the temperature of that water well. And then down in here, right up in there, that's the end. Come on, focus. Down in here, that's the end of the thermostat well. So we'll insert the end of the thermostat probe in there, and we know it's in contact with the liner. Now go ahead and continue cleaning this up, preparing it for going back together. So I figured out how I'm going to put this back. These sticks you see, a foam board or spacers, this is going to be the new top insulation piece that goes in there. And the spacers are just to keep it from going in too far, getting pushed down past the top like the old one was. So that's as far as that'll go. Now some people may disagree with this, but I'm going to fill the bottom part of it with foam. That's the best thing I can think of to ensure that it is, you know, feasibly well insulated and everything in there is sealed so moisture won't get in it. Then once the foam is set, this top ring I'm going to vinyl wrap in black vinyl, press it down in there, and then use black silicone to seal it. And I'm going to be using, you know, low odor products that aren't going to put a smell in the water. And that should get the thermostat well fixed, the insulation fixed, and the first step toward going back together with it. So I'm going to get back on this Frigidaire water cooler today. I had discussed replacing the insulation in this top piece, which I did. This is foam board, vinyl wrapped, black vinyl, and it's sealed with black silicone to bond everything together. And this is filled with new insulation. I have the drain tube here, so if water gets spilled, it'll fall down in there and won't just sit up here and eventually find its way into the insulation. So yeah, now it's time to get on to the cooling system repairs. So as I said last time, I drained the oil and I'm going to go back with fresh oil. And then, but before I do that, I'm going to cut this line and put a dryer in it while I still have the system discharged. So this has a restrictor up in the top. So this is not actually a capillary tube per se, and I can actually install the dryer at this point. It'll be okay there because it's still liquid at this point. I was looking through the parts bin, and I have this dryer. It looks like it'll be feasible in there. I'm not exactly sure how I'm going to arrange the lines, so I'm not going to try to video that because I need to be able to think about what I'm doing. So when I come back, this dryer should be installed in this line right here, and it should be time to draw in some oil. Actually, I lied. I'm going to put the dryer in the bottom. This is that liquid line. I can put this in the bottom where it'll be out of sight, out of mind. That'll be a lot better. And there we have a dryer. That should help keep anything from freezing up and help keep everything clean for the foreseeable future. Alright, I gave it a little bit of a bath while all the electrical parts were off of there. So you probably hear the vacuum pump going in the background. I've got a equally measured amount of new oil with a little bit of the Supco S88 additive. This is the same stuff that I put in there that helped get it to free it up and make it start pumping again, but I just put a touch of it up to make it red. And to draw that in, I'm going to take out this oil plug, the same one that I took out and had the foam come out. Set that aside and on a clean rag. So now I've got a threaded stud with a hole in it. This 5/16 fine thread. And this hose, I had already previously washed it out. So I'm going to set it down, set the measuring cup down there below the... So I want that hose to sit down in there by itself without me having to hold it and be all the way on the bottom. Put a little spacer under it. Now when I turn on the vacuum pump, it's going to pull vacuum on the low pressure side of the system, and this port's on the high side, so it's going to be going through the restrictor device, and so it's going to go slowly. That's why I wanted the support for the cup. I don't want to have to hold it. Well, we'll see if it starts going in. My concern is that the threads are going to leak air around the fitting I made, and that it's not going to develop vacuum. But actually, the oil's going in. That's good. See the level going down. I'll pick it up so that it gets every last drop. I want it to have every chance it can to have a healthy life. That is the last of that. So the next thing to do will be to clean off this plug. Don't want any dirt or grit on it. And put it back in there. So at that point, she should have a full new oil charge. Get that plug tightened in there. So before I stand it upright, I'm going to go ahead and make up the cable that goes to the compressor terminals and get that installed. That way I don't have to keep leaning it over and picking it up as much. Alright, through the miracle of video, new compressor cable just appeared magically. So I'm going to take some dielectric grease, put on these terminal studs, help them out a little bit, and then put this on. It should go back on the way the old one came off, I would hope. One at a time, you know. I've tried to be careful not to blast water right around these studs when I was doing the wash job. I think I did fairly good at that. Because, you know, why tempt fate? We know this is a sensitive area on these compressors. That red one, I may have to expand the terminal or the ring a little bit, get it to fit on there. But I think the white and black are going to go on fine. Just like so. Have to figure out how to get that expanded and get it on there, but you get the picture. All right, new cable is in place. Oil plug is tightened. Dryer is there. Time to set this back upright. So you'll have to excuse the rain noise a little bit. So that came today. And while it was raining, I rewired the whole unit. That's where the thermostat will go. That's just a jumper in there. Been under vacuum for about 4 hours. So, gonna try to charge it up, see if it's gonna work. This one was a R114 unit, so I'm gonna put this 1234ZE in there, which is lower pressure than some other refrigerants. It should be a little easier on the machine. First thing I'm gonna do is isolate the vacuum pump. Shut that down, and now aside from the rain, that'll make it a little quieter in here. And I'm going to hook up the can of refrigerant. This is an automotive style can tap, supposed to be R12 or R134A can, but this is the same size as an R12 can, and it felt like it was going to break, so I got cable ties on there instead of the latch. It's really crap quality. The old one I have, the Four Seasons one, the blue one, that does only R12 size cans. That one is, you know, well, it's vintage. And that one doesn't have any trouble. I don't know what's up with this one. So, as usual, I'm going to purge any air out of the high-pressure hose. Then when I open this valve, try to get the gauges to show up. I'm sorry, guys. I'm fighting with the camera today. So we're in a vacuum, got pressure from the can coming in here. This hose is blocked by an isolated vacuum pump. We'll let some vapor go in, get the system out of vacuum. All right, that's all it's going to take in, not running. So we'll focus the camera down on the gauges and the kilowatt so we can see what sort of things are happening there and come back. All right, that's looking better. I got to be mindful of this hose in the way of the picture. So we're going to plug in the compressor to the switch box. See the amp draw. And they'll go for a start. And this is the first time since the rewiring, so I really don't know what's going to happen. No start. But I'm going to do a little wiring troubleshooting, and I will come back and see what I can say. Okay, so I made an extremely ugly temporary start relay hookup just to get going, because I want to get the charge in the system. Well, it's all hooked up to the gauges, and then later I can work with the electrical side. So, once again, we're going to try for a start and see what happens. All right, it's pulling back into a vacuum. So, I'll give it some more refrigerant. Can is getting cold. of course, drawing out of these cans, you want to make sure this port is above the liquid level so that it doesn't take in liquid. Just feeling for warmth in there, trying not to shock myself in the process. The evaporator on this cooler is a really heavy brass part. So what I expect it's going to do is take a lot of effort for the compressor to cool that brass down. So we may see a good bit of power demand here at first. Don't look too close at all that. Trying to feel for any cooling. I hear gas flowing through, that's good. Okay, I have the pan of warm water here. Put the refrigerant can in it, start boiling it off. You see it's built up with ice along the bottom. See the power demand going up as we're putting more heat energy into the system that's having to deal with and condense. Low side pressure is going up as well. Feeling just a little bit of warmth in that. I'm going to close it off now. Let the compressor run until it warms up. Because what I don't want to do is let it build up liquid in the compressor sump, and then as it warms up, it'll be overcharged. So I'm going to give it a little bit of stabilizing time. And then I'll come back and we'll see what it's doing after it's warmed up. Well, it's probably been another 15 or 20 minutes, and the pressure is building up on the low side, it's not as much vacuum, and the power demand is going up. So that tells me that it's reached a point now where the liquid refrigerant that condensed in the compressor housing has started to boil off and circulate. And if I touch the top of the compressor, it's just warm, not hot, just a little warm. And if I feel inside the cooling chamber up there, it's starting to cool. So it's building up heat and starting to actually work. And like I said, these old Meter-Miser systems, high side dome, high side housing, they take their time to warm up. It's probably 75 degrees in here. Just let her keep running for a little while. Well, after about another 10 minutes, the power demand isn't going up anymore, so I think whatever's in there is circulating. So I'm going to put the can back in the warm water. It's not really that warm anymore, but back in the water. We'll start giving it some more refrigerant. What I want is for the condenser to start rejecting heat, because that tells me that the refrigeration cycle is working. Valve it in and let it stabilize like that a little while. So the cooling chamber on top is getting cold, but it's not frosted. In a few minutes, I'll pour some water in there for it to cool down to give it more heat load. But I know it's less stressful on it if it's getting heat only from one source. Right now, it's only getting heat load from the refrigerant can. So I'm trying to let the charging process go by as stress-free as possible. Give it a little bit more. All right, I'm about to pour normal cool tap water into the cooling chamber and add some heat load to the system. We'll see what kind of response it has on the gauges. Pouring the water in now. So that's about 3 quarts of just ambient temperature tap water. You can see that's brought the pressure up quite dramatically, and the power demand. So I stuck the thermometer down in there. So we're at like 56 degrees to start with.